Our world is constantly evolving. As time moves forward, things change, which is why it's important to stay informed. Throughout the year, there are dozens of professionals that share their expertise with the community through lectures sponsored by local government agencies and area not-for-profits. And each month, SLCTV will feature one of these visiting professors as they discuss the latest current events. So grab a notebook and pull up a chair, because the lecture hall is about to begin.
Wow, I'm real humbled to see so many people here this morning. This is my time for give back. I've been in photography for 71 years and went through a lot of different things. Met some of the greatest people. Ansel Adams was a good photographer, I think. And the one I really enjoyed the most, because he was a tough guy and he told you exactly how he felt. Whether you like it or not, this is what he said. And that was Arnold Newman. And Arnold Newman said to me, if you think you're an artist in photography, then why are you doing photography by rules? There are no rules in art. Rules kills creativity. That's what he pounded into my head every time I saw him, because he didn't like the PPFA. We were all in the box. We all did everything the same. So he wants you to be yourself. So what I'm trying to, if I can get something across this morning for you great people that showed up, to take back with you, is just the art of seeing. It's your eyes, not mine. I see something a little different than you. Everybody here has an input. If I sent you all out to take one picture of one item, you'd all come back with a different view, a different look, and that's what's so great about photography. There's no bad photographs. There's just photographs that don't quite, weren't cropped a little bit, or maybe image brightness and contrast. I think that's the one I use most of the time because it gives me everything I want, and we'll try to go through that. I was a portrait photographer. I did the very wealthy, Rockefellers and people like that. And I went to their homes. And you know, after 10 years of doing that, we get in ruts. We all get in ruts. And we think, oh, what am I gonna do next? I wanna take a picture, but I don't know what to take it of. So I said, you know, I have 9 view cameras from 11 by 14 down to a 4 by 5. I'm just gonna take one and dedicate it to scenic photography. And I'm just gonna travel around, just take mountains and rocks and take pictures of what I want. This is my photography now. So I don't really care what anybody else feels about it, because it's my feeling of the way to let loose of my portrait business and do something different. So that's what I've been doing over the many years. So now today, I've tried to put this all together. I gave the program very similar to this, but I added a lot to it, and it's a little longer this morning. Okay, let's have the first one, and the first one should be of art. When I started to try to learn to be art, were you born a photographer? How do you become a photographer? Every day, in every way, we get better and better. Bit by bit, just a little bit. We never are terrible and then we're great. There is no great photographers. There's only photographers that have worked at something, dedicated their lives to doing it, and come up and get good at it. So you can't be a dentist, a carpenter, a plumber. You'll never be any good at anything. So I was a portrait photographer. I dedicated my life to that. And now I'm trying to get into this. So I went to the art museums. I used to go to the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York at least 3 times a year and spend all day, my wife and I, and we'd study the art of light. Light is all we have to work with. That's the most important part of photography. Light direction, where is it coming from? Light quality, does it put you in a mood? Or is it harsh and dark? Or is it light and airy? So you get moods from it. So you have light direction, light quality, and light intensity. And that's the darkness of the light and the lightness of it. And here we have 2 little boys painted by somebody back, a Dutch painter back in the 1700s. And look at how they brought the yellow light in. Yellow is the red and yellow, your eyes go right to it. You can't miss the photograph. You can't miss the 2 boys. But look at what he did all around. Darkened it all the way around so that your eye stays within the picture. They'll have a profile and a full face. The full face is in what we call a split light, because the light only comes from one direction. So I don't want to fill in that split light. I want that darkness there because that gives it roundness. Darkness makes your highlights pop. Because if you don't have deep, if you don't print your, my work is printed pretty deep, because the deeper you print, the lighter the highlight gets. So it makes more of a three-dimensional look to it rather than a washed out muddy print, we called it. So now go on to the next one. And the next one, look at how they use light in here and hands coming out of nowhere. But yet right here is a child and the mother. Well, there's two children and a mother and a third child. And then you go on and, oh, look at the animals and look at, he's in a profile, but he's in the dark in the profile. She's in a light in the profile. So they followed the direction of light on every person that they painted. And then it takes your eye up around and you come back into the picture. All this stops your eye from going out. So you keep going around and that keeps your eye in. That's called good composition. Next. Now here, what did I say? Yellow and red make orange. But it makes it the most powerful part of the photograph. So your eye comes in with this big mountain, over the mountain, you come in, you bang, hit this, it can't go any further, you come back and see the deer down here. If I'm in your way, I'm sorry. And you can get to see the whole painting. So that's what the artist had in his mind, to bring out the deer and have your eye come around to that part. So that's what a photograph is, telling a story. We want to follow the direction that the artist has made in this photograph. Next. Now, light. Look, the direction of light is coming from all over. Look at how wonderful you can see the depth, how thick the walls were. You can see the hole because it's dark behind it with a white. Dark with a white, all white, and then you come to this side, and this is dark with light. So you can go through the whole photograph without getting bored, because each one, then you come down to the holes, and look at the cracks, and it's all because the light came in at the right time of day. This photographer, it's a painter, I'm sorry. This painter knew what time of day he or she wanted and painted it just like that. This is really a colored picture, but I didn't want you to see the color. I wanted you to see the light. So whenever you want to see if your image that you just took is a good image, a good exposure, make a black and white out of it. It will tell you right away, oops, this is flat. There's no highlights. Oops, this is too contrasting. So that's what I always do is change it to black and white, see where my strength is, and then go back and fix it in Photoshop. Next. Now look at this, Monet. He made this yellow. And then here's the major part, the city, all white, right in the middle. It's in the middle. Some judge will go, oh, it's in the middle, no good. Ding, out. It's only worth $8 million, this painting, you know. I'd like to sell one picture for $1 million, but anyway. But he made this green. Why? Because your eye will go, no, I don't want to go there. I want to go back to the white, yellow, then to, oh, no, back again. So you're staying in the painting. So there's a method to the madness of painters. Next. Okay, now you all are familiar who enter competition that some judge will get up and say, I can't hang that, it's in the middle, a target or something. Well, I don't know any painter, this is Gainsborough, I don't know any painter that never painted a portrait in the middle of the paper, because they didn't go by one-thirds like we do. Here is a Gainsborough, middle of the paper, but put a tree there. Your eye goes to the tree and bounces right back into the picture. So you can't get away. You go, oh, a tree, back to the image, and how beautiful the image is in that. It was in painting, but in the book I have, they're all black and white. Cheap book, I guess. Okay, Now, here is an image of a lily. It's in the middle of the thing. Why is it in the middle? Because power comes by the largeness of it. So here we have a large image. Your eye can't go any place except to that. So that's the first thing in composition, bringing your eye to the motif or the primary part of the photograph. And then a primary has a lot of secondaries. Secondaries are the little loop here, there's green pads here. Those are all adjectives in a photograph to help you make the image primary better. So it's telling you a story about the image. It's in a pond with lily pads around it. So you still have secondaries, but they're smaller and the main is large. So now we go to another one. Now here's the 1/3 Leonardo Fibucci back in 1160. And I don't think he was a photographer because that was a long time ago. And he was a mathematician. And he said, we see 57 or 58 degrees wide and 34 degrees high. That's how I see. I can see those ends there, the two people sitting, and I can see it. That's called the rules of thirds or the golden section. Golden section, you have it every day. Seconds, minutes, and hours. Three things. So everything's built around three or 1/3. So this one, I put in 1/3. Your eye, all the things go and it ends up, this keeps you in so you can't miss that beautiful color. Next. Okay, now we have two. And if they were the same color, you might go boom, boom, boom. But here we come in, pow, white. And isn't that pretty? Back to the white. So your eye stays in the photograph. And then you have the lily pads, but very little. And this is printed very lightly for here. It's most of my work, if you see, is printed much darker. Next. And here's three. Three is a triangle. Triangle in composition is the most powerful, strong image you can make. When we make family groups in triangles, it's powerful, it's strength. So you go, you see all the secondaries. This has a lot of secondaries in it. And that's all telling a story about where they came from and then where they go. See how that pretty one up at the top? So you get to look at things in the photograph. Because if you can't study a photograph and see things going on, then it doesn't tell a story. Next. Okay, children playing. I try not to put any portraits, but this makes a 1/3. Now everybody says, well, 1/3 should be here. No, 1/3, you draw a tic-tac-toe, and there's four points of intersection. Those four points are what's called I 83 years old, I start to forget things. Intersection, the point of steel, no, that's another one. But that's the most important part of a photograph. Impact sections, there's the word I was looking for. That's impact sections, four of them. So I put it in the high section. They're looking down into a field of flowers because that made more sense to me. But of course, whenever I take an image, I take at least this much more all the way around it. Because I always, once, what I love about the zoom, remember with my 8x10 view camera, I didn't pick it up and go back. We got exactly what we took. But we didn't have Photoshop to crop it. So I had my cropper was a cutter. I just, then a little more. Okay, that's it now, that's a good one. So now with Photoshop, all I do is when I have my camera set and I take it, it's on 80 millimeter, boom, 90 millimeter, boom, 100 millimeter, boom. Now I take the three, put them up on Photoshop, and I go, that one in the middle is the best. Get rid of those two and work on that one. So I have ways of seeing what I did. I don't have to develop the film and wait a week for it to come back to see what I have it instantly, and it's very great to be able to go and do something on your and work on your photograph and not lose it as long as you back it up all the time. Oh boy. But that's the rule of thirds. Okay, next. Okay, again, back in the middle of the subject. Foggy day. All you can see is the tree, but you see a tree in the water too. So it's a bound, bound, bounce there. I have bushes here. The bushes stop me from going out so I can come back and see the center of the tree is the most important part in the fog. And that's the story with the river. Now, if anybody has a question, please ask me, because I don't know what I'm talking about all the time, and I just get talking. So my wife calls me motor mouth. Did she go out? She was my retoucher. She made all my work look great all through the years, so I paid her exactly what I got. So back in the 60s, I wasn't a womanizer or what. Now, I wasn't against women. So I gave her the same check I took when we were a corporation. So I made a check for her and a check for me. Of course, she got both of them anyway, but next. Okay, a lighthouse in Nova Scotia. It was a little bit foggy, and so it's handheld, and I had a 35-millimeter X-pan, Hasselblad X-pan. And it's a long, two exposures long, beautiful size negative. And I made a black and white, and I made a carbon print. It's over there. And the carbon print is not sharp. It's, you know, some photographers go, it's got to be sharp or it's out. No, it's got to be ethereal. It's got to be artistic. It's got to look different. I don't want every picture to look sharp and look the same. Everything I do, I want to try something different every time. HDRs, we'll go into that. I have a lot of fun with that. Okay, next. Now the next one, the same camera, but this is now sharp because I wanted to see the branches and the images, so that was taken in a fog. These were all color slides that I converted on the scanner and printed on carbon paper. Carbon printing is the one item that will never fade or go bad. It will last forever because it's made out of Knox gelatin, sugar, alcohol, oh wow, that's great, and the pigment that you want. India ink, black, brown, olive, or now they have the new green that I've been playing with. Next. And oh, here's one-thirds, and this is the one that I want you, can you crop this one? Now, you look at it, and that's one-thirds, and now some will like it, some won't, and that's okay, it's all right. So if you say you don't like it, I don't get mad at you, it's okay. So I want you to crop it in half. Whoop, it keeps disappearing. Oh, get to Photoshop, okay. No, we're gonna try to show you, you have many ways of doing this cactus. How do you wanna do it? Now, crop it right about here. Can you see that? Right. And give me that side.
You see the little X there, is that where you
want? Okay, good, down and over. Good, now get rid of that side. Now think of this the way it is, and now look at it this way. So now, what's you're capable of doing is putting this up on your computer and doing this. Now you can put a mask around it and you can still see it in the background of the mask. I don't know how to do that here. But so now that gives you the ability to see further than just the way it was. Now I'm not saying this is better than the other. I'm just giving you the option of playing with it and getting emotional about it. Say, oh, I like this so much better. When I hear that, I get real turned on. I love that. Especially when the woman starts tearing. I brought some family pictures the other day to the woman, and she cried, and she put something on my pocket. I said, what are you doing? She says, oh, just take that home. I know, I can't get paid. I don't want the government to know I'm around. So now I go home, and I pull out a $100 bill. Yeah, and I was amazed. Okay, next. Okay, here's another one. which can you crop from this about here to about here? Where'd it go?
Oh.
Yeah.
Back to it. I'm sorry.
Okay, crop it.
I was trying to get it into the Photoshop there.
Okay. So what we're going to do is maybe you'll say, well, I just want the boats. You know, I love the art directors. After you take the picture, they go, no, I just want this. Okay. So now we go back and have to take another one. But here I don't have to take another one. I can just crop it. And okay, so now, yeah, crop it just a little bit more about here. Okay, that's good. That's good. Then just go all the way across to here. Boop, that's good. Now get rid of it. I just hit the little tool up there and it disappears. Crop, there you go. So maybe you might like it better that way. You know, and you can crop down a little bit, but you like to keep some of the reflection in the water. I don't want to tell such a big story with all the buildings around it. I just love those boats and I want to show it. Not, I don't really. I mean, I'm saying somebody would say to me, oh, I just want the boats. Can you get rid of all the other? Sure. And that's what I would do. And that's what they would buy. But they'll only pay me $100 more because I had to crop it. Here. I brought these because I don't know about you, but I like to touch things and smell them, see what they look like. And this is what we read from left to right. So therefore, we want to make it so our eye comes in from the left side, enjoys what we see, and stays there instead of leaving a trap door, we call it, to go out of the picture. So now, what I did was, I took a heron and I flopped it, and I showed one is coming at you and one is going away from you. This is personal, I like to come in and see the bird so I can stay here. This way I go out there and wonder where he's going. Over here, you're coming in the rear end of the bird, I'd rather come into the face. So if you want to pass these around and just kind of look at what I was talking about, I didn't realize there'd be so many people, but you could just pass it around. I've had those for years now. So I do a lot of flopping. Flopped in the image. Because sometimes it makes more sense to me. Now I know if it's got writing on it, I'm going to have to take it out. I know if it's for history, I can't do it. But I know that I can do it when I enter prints in competition because the judges aren't too smart and I have to help them out. So I want them to see what I'm talking about because if they don't understand, the score goes low. And I'd hate to have to put a hit on any juror that gave me a low score. But so this is what we call flopping the image to see if it creates a better look. And what's nice, you can see it right away, and your mind, some way in your mind, it's going to say, oh, I like so much better that one. Great, then that's the one you use. I may like the other one, so I use the other one. Next. Okay, here's a picture of a scene out a window at New York State Convention when it was snowing, and my wife's 35 millimeter was there, so a Nikon, and I took it. And at those days, new black and white film just came out, 3200 film. Grainy as anything, but I love the grain. So I always had a roll in my pocket. I got 12 exposures. I could buy 12, 24, or 36. So I bought a lot of 12s because I didn't want to shoot up a whole roll to get one picture. So I took this out the window of the dining hall when we were eating. I said, wow, look at that. It's snowing, the snow, but I don't get the feeling that I want to sit in that chair. I get the feeling I want to go across and go out. So what I did was, I cropped it. I flopped it, I mean, not cropped it. And you can pass it on and take a look. That's that the new film back in 1970. It was new. And okay, so I flopped that one to get so your eye would come through and I can sit down there. We're going to do horizontal flop. See, now I come in and sit down and enjoy the view. That's the way my mind is. I see it that way. And sometimes other people don't. But do you understand what I'm saying? The idea is to stay in the photograph and enjoy. Look at there's no horizon line. The horizon line is all over because the lake isn't the ocean. So I don't worry about horizon lines. Next. Now here's through the windows of my house. We get all kinds of fowl in the backyard, in the pond. And here they come, and that would be, my title would be Wrong Way, Charlie. You know, and he's going, but I thought it was pretty neat. But then I may put it up that way. And so again, I'm giving myself the idea that, do I like it this way or do I like it the other way better? And either way is good, because the birds haven't changed, only their direction. One, they're coming at you, the other, they're going away from you. Next. Okay, I came to this waterfall. My eye goes to the waterfall, but then that rock is so big and so light in color that my eye flows through the photograph to the rock. So I flopped it. Now my eye comes to here, but ends up at the waterfall because this is dark now. I can't go past it. So now I can enjoy the waterfall a little bit more. Now that's the way I see things, you know. Somebody else may not agree, and that's okay. Next. Okay, here's the white sands down in New Mexico or down there. And these are 5x7 negatives. We're out there early in the morning. And that's when I was a lot younger. And that's the way I took it. And to me, I'm going out of the picture because it's drawing me across to go out. So here I can enjoy it first and then see everything else going on. Next. Any questions, just holler. Okay, now photographing landscapes. And here's the tic-tac-toe. But now it's just a horizontal one, no vertical lines. So what we're worrying about is where to put the horizon line. Don't put it in the middle. Oh boy, you won't get scored good. But composition says the bottom part will show more sky. So you better have a great sky to show if you're only going to put the bottom one-third land. Here it's snowing on top of Guadalupe Mountain. And I got up early in the morning, my wife and I, to go up a mile up on this mountain to photograph the scenery. And I have my shorts on, and we go out, drive up, and it's snowing on the top of the mountain. I mean, so she had to come out with an umbrella, and I'm out taking a picture of the umbrella. Now these, remember, when you're photographing white, add 1 to 2 f-stops of light. Because your reflective light meter wants to read 18% gray. So it's going to say, oh, that white is too white, I'm going to make it gray. Well, snow isn't gray, it's white. So you have to overcome the light meter and add another stop to 2 stops when you're photographing snow. That will make it pure white and you can work with that. Okay, so this I had to add, it's normally 6-second exposure. So if I want to add 1 stop, that's 12-second exposure on my 5x7 view camera in black and white film that was only 100 ASA. It's ISO now. I used to be an American, but now it's international. And I still remember ASA. So now down here, Peggy's Cove, it's an inlet, so the water doesn't have a place to go. But yet the background comes down to a point. So it looked nicer coming down to a point and then coming back and seeing the shadow, and the bulk of that darkness brings you back into the photograph. At least that's the way I see it. So there's the thing we worry about most is scenics, where to place it. Nobody can tell you before you take a picture how to make a composition. You have to go to a scene and say, okay, oh, that I like that right there, and then put your camera up and take that. Now you're making the composition. And when you bring it in Photoshop, now you're enhancing the photograph, making the composition a little tighter. And that's where I like to do it a little larger than I have, so I can take off a little bit on the right side. Maybe I don't want so much on that side. So I'll take a little bit off the right, a little bit off the bottom. I'll make a panorama out of it, because I love panoramas. I do a lot of those. Next. Okay, here's a typical. This is your horizon line. It's mountains and beautiful sky. That's out in Colorado, through the window of a car. Okay, next. Oh, this is at the top of the mountain, Guadalupe Mountain. And that's the long exposure in the fog, and in the it was snowing, so it looked foggy. But it's different, and I have a dark tree to bring your eye into it. And you can see the snow and the darkness where there's no snow on the branches underneath the trees. The snow didn't seem to land on there.
So there's not exactly a horizon on this one.
No, there's no horizon at all. But I just felt the whiteness deserved a little bit more space, because I cropped it right above the tree, and it just seemed it didn't fulfill the snow coming down. So I had to show more of the snow. So I put it back in. I like better a little higher than. Okay, now we're down in Arizona, and this is a very special tree. I flopped it because I wanted to come in to see all the other bushes that they have, and there's the motif, or the primary, is the big tree. It's darker, and it's got more impact than anything else. And that's why I flopped that one, because I liked it better. But if I were to give it to the Arizona desert people, I'd leave it the other way, because that's history, and I don't want to corrupt history. Next. Oh, and I'm out in the car in Connecticut, and with the panorama, and there's four or five deer in here. And I named it for the judges, how many deer can you find? Now right away they go, how many deer? So they forget the photograph, you know, and now that I got a high score on it. But that's the snow. And that's two stops brighter for the snow. The dark still goes dark, but that's the balance it is. The camera didn't get the balance. It wanted to give it less light. That would have gone black there, because there'd be no exposure in there.
How many deer are in there?
What's that?
How many deer are there?
I forget. My wife counted them. There's one, two, three, there was four. And there might be another one. I'm up awfully close, it's hard to see. But there's three right there. And they, when I got there, they took off. My car scared them. And I was sliding on the road, it was all ice. Next. Oh, that's only a part of it. Can we get more? That's not even half of it. I made these large so that it would be on a big screen, but there we go. This is Nova Scotia in the fog when I took the lighthouse. And this is with a regular Hasselblad, 2 1/4 square. And the inlet's over there, and you enjoy the boats. And here's the pier that stops you from going any further. And the three different primary colors, almost primary, not quite. But it lent to a nice feeling. So I took it, and I made $750 at a competition down in Photo Fusion. And I won that year. And that was 2003, and that picture took it. Next. Oh, this one is in Nova Scotia, same time, only on a different pier, showing it was too foggy to fish, I think I named it. And it came up, no, first my wife's print came up of a butterfly, 100. And she got 100. And about 10 prints later, this comes up, 100. Now there's five judges in the PPFA. There's five judges. And my wife and I were saying, we both got 100. And then all of a sudden, John, he's a good friend of mine, he was a judge. He said, no, excuse me, I have to challenge this. I just don't like the mat. I have to knock some points off for the mat. So he knocked off 4 points. Well, he knocked 5 off. But then the other judge said, no, I don't think it's that necessary. So we'll only knock 3 off. So they, between the 5 judges, it got a 97. Well, my wife beat me out. Next. Okay, and the balloons. And you're walking around with the balloons. All of a sudden, there's that big one closer to you. And the other two are down low. So my eye can come in and see the people, what they're doing. And then the lines take you up to the big balloon. And you stay in the picture. You don't go out of it. You stay right in the picture that way. And the colors are so brilliant. And so the story is, look at the beautiful balloons and how they all are different in their color and in their shapes even. They had some animal shapes there too. This was at Gatlinburg, Tennessee. And they had that. This was the yearly balloon raising, whatever they call it. Next. Okay, now I want you to go into images, bright and contrast. Now, that's the way the camera saw this. Okay, now that was really an HDR, and I took the middle exposure. I do 2 stops under and 2 stops over and a normal exposure. This is the normal exposure. Well, it falls kind of flat. You see what I mean? The camera doesn't see what your eye sees. I saw a lot more contrast and deepness. So I want you to darken this down. Okay, now go down to contrast and push it all the way to the other end. Keep going, just push it all the way. Now, do you see? It didn't take a miracle, it just took a little bit to start to look like I may do it again. I may make it a little deeper because, you see, as it darkens, these highlights get brighter because our eyes see it that way. It's not really getting brighter. It's always been that brightness, but there was nothing around it to show you the intensity highlight. That's a specular highlight. There's no detail in a specular highlight. It's just pure white. So therefore, by making everything else darker, it makes that brighter and it gives it more impact and more dimension. It's a three-dimensional photograph. And if we were to go again, and now you can click OK and bring it up again. Now bring up that again. Do you have quick mask? Can you do it? Okay. Now don't touch brightness this time. Just contrast. Now put it all the way to the end again. There. Wow. So you see what you can do with just brightness and contrast. Sometimes that really puts the picture in another mood. Because many times I judge and the pictures just don't pop off the paper, because they're too lightly printed. We have to print deeper to get the image, and all the image has darkness, but yet there's texture there that comes out more as you darken it. So now, and they were green because it's in the swamps. Okay, so you got the idea of the image darkness, how I like to do it and play with it. And usually I have to go to the second one to get it. Now that may be a little too dark now. I may go back a little bit, but you play with it. And I do a quick mask where I have it, hit it over here and it comes up. Because I like the quick mask, it puts it on another layer. I can turn that layer off and turn it on by hitting a little button I on it. So now I hit it. What did I do to it? Hit that button, you'll see right away what you did to it. And then hit it again to bring it back again. So you can play with it and see what you've done, how far you went. Maybe you went too far. So I'll bring it back just a little bit. So this will come back up, the brightness, and you can do it. Now, I have something, you don't have it on yours. But underneath here, there's a line of tools. And in the middle, it's quick mask. I do that for all. For instance, suppose I wanted to get rid of, I wanted this to be dark. I would go up into the loop tool. Where is it? Oh, it's the third one, the fourth one. Yeah, I think that's the loop tool. Okay, so I would take the loop tool and I would go all around this.
No, don't
worry about it because it's too hard to do. And I don't see it. I would select an area and then I'd hit quick mask and brightness and dark, and contrast again would come up the same as it did here. And only that would go darker until it's where I want it or lighter. So you can play with that. And then you go up into filter, and it goes down filter, the tool, blur, Gaussian blur, 43%, I have mine on usually, and hit that. And the line that you put around it disappears from blur. Really is neat. And that way I can control items in here that I want. If I want that tree to be darker, I'll just loop that and make that darker by selecting that section and making it darker. Okay, I guess that's enough of that. Let's go on to the next one. This is McKee Garden, HDR. It's a little underexposed, it should be darker, but because you don't see what's going on here if it's too light. As soon as you darken it down, all of a sudden, oh, I can see the shapes in there now. We don't see them now. So things have to fall together. When you're looking at a print and you say, gee, it looks like it's blue, look in the highlights. Look in the diffused highlights on the shirt, white shirt. If it's got a tinge of blue in it, it's too blue. So you have to add a little yellow to get rid of the blue. So that's a balancing print. And if you don't like this green, then you would add a little red to it. And that would neutralize some of the green in the picture. And that's all your feeling when you look at it. Nobody can tell you what to do. You have to feel it. When you look at it, you say, something's wrong with it. Now what's wrong? Ah, I'll just move that. And it clears it up. Miracle. Wow. Next. Okay, this is the Tetons. This is three exposures horizontal. I started. I used to do five exposures on a HDR. The reason I do HDRs is I'm from the old zone system where we exposed for the shadow and developed for the highlight. So the shadow comes up at 40% of developing, so you can develop it all day. The shadow's not gonna come up anymore. Only the highlight gets darker and darker and darker. How dark do you want it? Well, I have a little mathematician thing next to me, and it says, for the exposure I gave it, I'm gonna knock off 2 minutes of developing time, and that won't burn up the highlight. So my negative, I can print it without dodging and burning. So now I come to digital. Oh, that stuff's terrible. Because you make an exposure, you lose shadows or you lose highlight. You can't have them both, especially on a contrasty day. On a rainy day, it's beautiful. You get everything because the difference between highlight and shadow is only about one f-stop difference. Once you go beyond two f-stops, no paper can handle it. The printers can't handle it. We spend so much on the printers and they're not even developed good enough yet to hit the whole spectrum. It cuts off a lot. So, HDR, high dynamic range. Wow, what is that? So Dan Burkholder said, Dick, it's a zone system. Give it two stops under, two stops over, and one right on. That was five exposures, one f-stop, one f-stop. So I'm on my Canon and going, click, move, click, move, click, move, click, move. I had to do that six times to get. Now with the Canon, they taught me to go in the back and look at, what did we call it, bracketing? Two over, two under, and one on. You put it there on the whole thing, and now you just put it on constant firing, and you hold continuous, that's the one, and you put your finger on, boom, 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 boom. I got my HDR out the window of the car almost, except you need a tripod because you can't move the camera. I have no pin things to register, pin registers to register them. It's all done in photo matrix and map toning. Great program. Got it from Dan Burkholder. He's good. So this is three horizontal. Three horizontal put together in photo merge in Photoshop, and that's what it comes up with. So three scenes, but nine exposures, because it's three exposures on each shot, a scene. Next. Now, that's the same one. Okay, now that one in the back. This is it. It's one of them. Yeah, I'm not sure if it's the same one, but this is eight HDRs, but three times eight is 24. So there's 24 exposures to make that. Once I make it, I take the HDR that I've worked on, I put them all into Photoshop Merge, and you sit there for about 30 seconds, and it pops up all done. That would have taken me 2 days in the dark of making hundreds of prints, cutting them so they've matched, and then glue them all together. That was a lot of work. Now I do it in 30 seconds. It's a lot of fun. So I love black and white, so I change it to black and white. And I think there's a black and white there in the frame on the bottom. I tried to bring all these prints here to show you what they look like in person. Next. Oh, that's the nine exposures in black and white. And that's the same as that, only that's in color and this is in black and white. Yeah, it's hard to tell a difference there. Okay, if I did horizontal, I could probably do it in half the exposures, but I would lose more of the top and the bottom. And I wanted the sky because it had those clouds in it. So by doing it vertical, I get more top and bottom. If I do it horizontal, it's going to be a long, narrow panel. I don't know. Like of the first print there, that's platinum palladium print. That's a very expensive print. That's of Appomattox and McLean House, where the two generals, Lee and Grant, signed the treaty. That's what that first print's all about. That was done with digital, and it was like four or five exposures horizontal. I wasn't into the vertical yet. So that's why they're long and narrow, because I didn't have any top and bottom on it. So now I know better, and vertical, we're gonna see some more. Let's go to the next one. Is the next one? Okay, this is, yes.
When you're doing your horizontal vertical, you're taking nine.
Yes.
You take the first shot.
Yes.
Then you have to move it.
Okay, I have it on a tripod that I can loosen the horizontal motion. I can move the camera horizontally without taking it off of the horizon line. So I put it on vertical and straight. And I figure I've got these two gentlemen in the picture. The next picture, I've got to get him in and him in. The next picture, I have to get him in and her in. I'm overlapping by 1/3 so that the machine doesn't get confused and make two prints out of it. Yeah, it will do that sometimes. But he's going to be in it and they'll see him in the next one. And then there's one up there. Oh, the orchestra. That's a photo merge, but not HDR, because that's handheld with a 300 millimeter up and as high as I can go in the balcony, shooting down on the symphony. And I did four vertical exposures, boom, 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 right across, and put them in merge and gave them that. Now, when you do that, my camera is normally 16 megapixels. When I make that, it's like 3 times 16. That's about a 48 megapixel image now. It makes it very big. So I have to knock it down to 30 because that top one is 30, and that's made at Sam's for $11. I can't beat them. As long as you know the profile that they're printing on and know that they print a little on the yellow side, I can make mine a little bluer and compensate for it. So when they print it, it's the blue I want.
Yeah, do you normally do this in manual exposure?
Okay, when I put it there, I focus on, let's say I'm doing this, I focus on right about here, because these are all done at F11. Now this is a 50D Canon. Yeah, Canon gave me all this. So it's not that I think Canon is great, but when you get it for nothing, it's great. So I've learned to use, every camera you learn to use, it doesn't matter what make it is. This is a Canon. And I start out, I focus with the automatic focus on, let's say I focus down here on this. Once I focus on it, then I take the automatic focus off. It doesn't focus again. It stays that way all through the sitting, the picture taking. Also, once I do that, I have to be careful the overlap as I move, like I said. And you take that off, and you set it for 3 exposures, and you just take your time and just move the camera and just boom, 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 boom. And you go right through the whole thing. And yes?
You set your bracketing before you shoot?
Oh, yes.
All right, so where do you do, because I have a Canon, so where do you?
Okay, if you, on the back of the Canon, there's a little wheel with a lot of little darts in it, like just a little wheel. And when you push on that, boom, it comes up all your settings. I put it on AV, and then I go down to a Kelvin temperature. Okay, this is done at 5,000 Kelvin because there's a lot of sun coming in, but there are some bulbs of yellow, and I want to balance my Kelvin temperature, so I fix the Kelvin temperature to about 5,000. Then I go in and set that bracket so that the two lines go out. I do the full range, 3 exposures, 2 on 2, over. And okay. It does it all automatic. It reads the exposure, fires it, because when you're in the church, this is a dark area. And if you don't use the automatic, what is it? No, not the bracketing. It tells you how much light's in there. Automatic light meter. Okay. If you don't use the same deal through the whole thing, then you have some very dark, some very light. I want it more constant so I can see the whole thing. So you notice how these are all HDRs. This is 18 HDRs. So 3 times 18. The top is 15 HDRs. That's St. John's the Ark, and this is St. Helens. St. Helens is a long, narrow church. That's harder to do. St. John's is more of a square, so when you're in the middle, boom, 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 you go right around. But when you're in St. Helens, you have to make closer pictures because one wall's right up next to you, the next wall's going down, way down. This wall is right across from you, but that's way down. So you may have to change the focus too on those. I probably changed the focus on those because I knew that was much further down. I shoot about F11 because F11 with a 50D, because it's a 1/3 sensor, gives it the most depth I can get. And I think another thing I should talk about is depth of field. In portraits, we say depth of field. Well, I know if I focus on you, then that's in focus, and this is in focus at F11. But now I'm photographing a scene, and there's nothing in front. I don't worry about the front anymore. So we're using hypofocal distance, the closest point to the furthest point. Infinity means it's all in focus past infinity. So now you worry about, so if I wanted to get this cord sharp, and I wanted to get those pictures sharp, on the Hasselblad, I could figure out at F16, it gives me from 3 feet to 20 feet in focus. That's how I did weddings. I never focused because I knew at F11, I had the hypofocal distance was from 3 feet to 18 or 20 feet. So I set the strobe, and it was an automatic strobe for distance. It was a tri-zistor, so I didn't have to keep setting it for distance because it automatically did it by reading the light at the distance that you're taking. So at the bride's coming down the aisle, there's the pew. I want to get a picture. That's going to be my middle focus. So the first one will be 5 pews up and 10 pews back. So I knew when she hit that 10th pew, I can start shooting right up to the 5th. I didn't have to stop and focus. So scenics are the same way. When you figure out, you're in the house. I want to get those walls sharp. I want the rug to be sharp. I want everything to be sharp. So I'm shooting F22 maybe. And there's something, a preset. You can push a little button on the side and it opens the back of the camera so you can see what you're looking at and to make the exposure. And it tells you if the distance is sharp for you.